It's getting dark a little too early. Are you missing the dearly bereft? Taking flight, and you could be here tomorrow. Taking flight, well, you could get here tonight. All right. Taking a spin through the neighborhood, the neighbors scream what you're talking about, cause I don't know how to let you in and I can't let you out. Not your only friend in this world. Can you take me where you're going if you're never coming back?
I'm gonna fly on down and fly away on my way.
Videos coming out all the time have sped up skateboarding to where now kids just think that's everyday deal. Stunts are on every video every other month. The stunts are coming out left and right. And the more stunts kids see, the more normal they think it is. And the more they just do it without hesitation. And the less hesitation, the more stuff's gonna get done. And now it's just like the barriers have already been broken down by Duffy and all the gnarlers. And now kids are just picking up where they left off. They just think that's normal. Let's just do it. I'll just grind this rail. And Trainwreck has the least amount of hesitation of any skateboarder I've ever skated with, ever. There is a handful of kids that have good style and they have the desire to throw themselves on anything in their path. every kid is getting so gnarly to where the point where they're even getting hurt. Know the consequences yet because they haven't even seen the consequences yet. They're just doing it all for the first time.
One of my favorite videos to watch, just because of the sheer oldness of it, is Mondo Vision. There's a little section called Gonzo Goes to New York, and it has some of the first footage ever filmed or put in a video of Mark Gonzalez skating a handrail, doing a switch ollie over hip, things that are still sick nowadays, like 15, 20 years later or something like that. It's just a cool video.
Every time we try to skate, there's always signs all over the place.
I didn't see none.
And then it's just like, signs everywhere, signs. Walking in the scenery, breaking my mind. Do this, don't do that, can't you?
And the signs said,
welcome to Westchester, where you can get kicked out of a street.
I tuck my hair up under my hat, and I went in to ask him why. He said, you look like a
skateboarder.
What?
Why?
It's a shopping center. You're in a Ford. How do I know you're a rent-a-cop?
I'm not a rent-a-cop. I'm one of your real cops. Yeah.
Show me.
Do this all the fucking time. Look at the
fucking
status.
He threw a nerve.
I just saw you slide down a railing.
He did not slide down. He's not even capable of sliding down a railing.
Where? Where's it messing up? I don't see any marks.
Dude, you're just
fucking pavement.
Dude. Right
there. No, all right. Why?
Because I know
I'm
my property.
That thing's like running on its own. Man, you're some kind of sinner.
Rent-a-cops are just half-assed cops that couldn't make it to be real cops. And real cops are just mad at the world because they were pussies in high school, and that's their only way of becoming boss, Bruce Springsteen.
Get the f*** out of here now! Now! It's a private property!
Private property, you can't be skating. You look at all this stuff.
You know, because I can get in the car and that damn skateboard cannot get away from me. And they will call out a team of officers and surround this place and just take everybody to jail.
Get your and get out of here before I call the cops.
No.
nice language at a church.
Just a lawn care guy. I'm not just a lawn care guy.
Just a lawn care guy.
You're just a lawn care guy.
See, you are.
Summer, dude, you were a smart ass last time.
What happens if I stay?
I gotta call a cop.
Well, I'll have at least 15 minutes to get away. And then I can scratch up the ledge a little more.
Go, please.
You have nothing to say. All you say is get up. Get up. I don't have to answer. Get up.
Well, then it'll take like 2 minutes to get inside and then find the number to the police.
It's 911.
Let's go.
Give me my board.
Well, get out.
Give me my board.
Get out there.
Now.
Yeah.
Now.
Get out.
Now.
You guys aren't gonna be able to skate here today.
F**k, it's you again.
Is a skateboard.
Legendary skater Wonton Animal Chin has been reported missing.
Skate and destroy. I love skate.
Shove off.
Skate and create. Skating great.
hit his head really bad.
Aww.
See some more snows in the mountains in eastern Arizona with some wet weather across Texas.
No secret that I've been a wrestling fan since I was a little kid, and I've made that widely known to anybody that would listen. And I got an email from a guy out here in Lorraine. He was connected with these guys over here at Universal Championship Wrestling, and that if I wanted to get involved in one of the cards, that I was more than welcome to come out and do it. So here I am. I want to be able to come out and get on the mic and get people interested in the story.
All right, listen up. It's plain and simple. I'm a skateboarder. I've come here tonight to Lorraine to prove a point. It's an open challenge. Take punk-ass bitch in the locker room.
I've been wanting to do this for a long time. I never pursued it. It just all kind of came together at one time, the school and then coming out here to Ohio. And it's kind of steamrolled. Going to the rest of school was a lot scarier than coming out here because I didn't know what to expect. Because I've heard horror stories about what happens at wrestling schools, about guys getting stretched out and being made to feel real pain. And I was kind of expecting that. I was hoping that wasn't going to happen because I didn't want to really have to kick somebody's ass. Because I would have. Some dude tried to stretch me out, I'd beat his fucking ass. I got in there and Jesse Hernandez, one of the trainers and one of the promoters for Empire Wrestling Federation, he showed me how to run the ropes, walked me through that, which I still kind of struggle with. That's really kind of difficult. That the next day I had big bruises on my back and my hip. And really, when you fall on that mat, it's not soft. It hurts, man. Like, you feel it, you know?
Hey, I can't believe how well Mike is doing here, man. We have never, never in our entire career had an individual come in and learn as quick as Mike does here. It's incredible. I'm really amazed. And I think our students here are getting a big kick out of this, man. They really love this. This guy is really, truly an athlete.
You know, when I first started here, bro, it took me a year and a half, dude, to get where I was at, you know, to become pro. Which looks like you can make it in one day, man.
Oh, yeah. Mike's doing pretty damn good for his first time. I can't believe it. Not a lot of guys come into these doors that can do as good as this guy's doing. I don't know what to say about this kid. I think he's got another shot at another career. He's a tough boy, and I can't believe he's hanging in like he is.
One day, I will be the proud owner of this belt. It will be mine one day, without question.
Are each and every one of you prepared for some knockdown, drag out, pillar to post, wall to wall, rock 'em, sock 'em, chair bashing, table smashing, head splitting, blood dripping, hardcore, kick ass wrestling? That's
when I was growing up, there wasn't, you know, when we'd watch videos, there wasn't really slam sections like there are now. Like, you didn't see people slamming and actually really get hurt, like hitting their head or like just getting tore up. Always like the little goofy slams, like POW video, like the funny slams. I don't know, looking back, the one slam that I remember that but still to this day, like I cringe, is Chris Miller slamming up like that. Watching that, that's probably the slam that stands out in my head the most of any slam, even today.
We'll be right back. Alex Arto.
Eric Bork.
Jamie Fortune.
Anika Kobian.
Kyle Kimberling.
Levi Marvin.
Quinn Montgomery.
Ryan Parsons.
Mike Rafter.
Tony Two.
Ron Whaley.
One's with us here right now. We're going to show you a little footage of him in a second. You're a young kid and you trust people who are putting stuff together. Your name, sir?
Mike Vallely.
It's not you.
I thought it was like one of the biggest career mistakes anybody could ever make.
I'm from way inland, so, you know, I just use my environment and just skate and make up tricks.
Actually had something planned a long time ago with Mike Trinasi, the owner of Plan B, before he got killed. He always wanted me to like build some ramp to break the world record for the highest air on. I wanted to kind of do it for him, for what we talked about before he got killed. So I always had that in the back of my head, like, yeah, I need to do this Guinness Book thing. I want to do it, you know, kind of for him in a sense.
You know, he came up with the idea of, hey, I want to build a big ramp. I want to set the world record. And this is my idea on how to do it. Would you guys want to do something like this? And I said, hell yeah.
After doing a couple big airs on that ramp, I realized you could land pretty far down on the transition and still make the air because there's so much transition to land on. I'm like, man, you could probably jump off that chopper into the ramp. Because I saw they were hovering above the ramp, to, you know, just checking it out. And I saw them doing that, and I was like, yeah, it looks like you could probably do that.
And then on a whim, Danny's like, I want to jump out of the helicopter. And so we're like, all right, so we talked the pilot into it, and he did it.
So I went up there and it took me a few tries. I slammed a couple times. And actually, it worked out though, and pulled it off.
So gnarly, that's what got most of the attention, but that was like totally spontaneous.
The air became irrelevant completely. People didn't even talk about the air. They were like, oh, you jumped off a helicopter, and I still hear it. And people don't even have any idea that I was more happy about doing the highest air than jumping off a helicopter.
Yeah.
It was so fun to walk away that day knowing what he did, and like that it was all on film and tape and photos and everything, just knowing how gnarly that was. I'd seen something that no one, not very many people in this world or even our industry had ever seen or would see again, really, to that level. It's that first time that someone does something like that and does it at that level, the 16-foot air or 14-foot kickflip, and to jump out of a helicopter all in one day within like 4 hours. It was mind-blowing. I had a hard time sleeping for a couple of days after that just because it affected me that much, you know?
Danny must have been 12 when he entered his first castle contest, because I think it was 12 and under, 1A. He won the keyhole, the pull contest, and he also won the slalom.
He may very well be one of the best slalom skaters in the world, and we just don't know that.
This little kid, like, he was smaller than I was, and it was just unbelievable to see the stuff that he was doing, like all the tech stuff, just the style of some little kid just packed with all this power.
What are you talking about? He freaked. He yelled at me for a while. He's like, man, you can't just quit. You tell me, he said word for word, you gotta tell me you quit the Bones Brigade. And like, he made me say it over and over, like, I'm okay, I quit the Bones Brigade, that's it, you know?
It's Danny, I think. What's he doing now?
Sorry,
the video's all done. Maybe you could be in the next one. But if you need
a board
or something, talk to Tony.
Well, watch this.
Holy crap.
You think you're gonna get a part of
the video? Well, I don't know, Dan. It's supposed to be over, but I'll tell you what.
On his own and in Temecula. He lived with his brother, and basically from the time he was 14, he was kind of just on his own. They lived in this house, and it was this house on the top of this hill. They had all this land, and he had his mini ramp and stuff like that.
I think of a trick. I don't know, when I'm sitting in my house, so I come down here and learn it.
We go down there, like, you know, there's no parents around. It's just straight, like, me and Danny at this house in the middle of nowhere, and it's like Danny's got all these ridiculous guns and motorbikes and cars and just all this crazy shit. It was like trampolines. It was just wake up. All right, what do you want to do? Danny comes out of the house, shotgun.
So he had like 4 motorcycles. He had no license. It was so crazy.
Better than me and rock and roll.
had a lot of arguments with Mike and Tony over it for a long time, and it finally came to the point one day where I was just like, you know, either cut the team down and get it back to where the company used to be, you know, a tight team, and that's why the company was so solid in the beginning, or I'm gonna go ride for somebody that has a tight team, and that's why I went and hooked up with Mark and Jason and rode for the blind for a while. We wanted to have a crazy tight team, but we wanted to create something new that was explosive like H was when it came out, and that was like where Plan B came into play. Plan B was like, had every angle of skateboarding covered.
Viewed out in this day as a bird skater, but his roots are street.
Definitely known in the vert world this would be one of the best vert guys, right? But I know for a fact that if he wanted to and he focused on that, that he could easily be hold that position in the street world too.
Just amazing that you go back and look at that footage from 10 years ago and he was doing stuff that people still today don't know how to do and would have a lot of problem doing.
Because Danny was one of the only guys you know, skating vert and street, and actually inventing stuff on both, you know?
That dude has so much skill on a skateboard, it's unbelievable.
He showed up at the Christmas party with a broken collarbone in a sling.
Master! Master! Where's the dreams that I've been after? Master! Master! Promised only lies! Laughter! Laughter! All I hear or see is laughter! 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 Laughing at my cries!
I knew he was unhappy, but he kind of sucker punched us with that leave at we showed up at San Francisco contest. And I showed up there and Mike told me, hey, those guys quit. I'm just like, kidding me? I thought it was a joke. I was like blown away. He's like, no, they quit. Sheffey, Mikey, Rick, they're all gone. I'm like, you know, it was insane. I was blown away by it. But at the same time, at that same contest where that went down, Jeremy Wray was quitting his sponsor and Ronnie Bertino. Those guys were pretty on fire at the time.
Hit him going like 6 miles an hour and killed him instantly.
Mike was such a surprise. I really went through that shock of not believing it. And after I went for a walk, I walked out of the world. And my first thought after that was, oh my, you know, his wife and everything, was Danny. What's gonna happen to Danny? And I think it impacted him a lot.
94, 95, down there. I was surfing in the middle of the summer on a pretty small bay. I mean, it was really shallow water because it was right on the beach, you know? And I forgot that it was that shallow, and I dove in head first and compressed my spinal cord, my vertebrae, and then hyperextended my neck, where my neck pretty much hit me in the stomach.
To put in perspective what he did, he dislocated his brain stem from his spinal cord in the joint called the atlas, which is, it's a, I guess, a joint that holds the two together. He stretched the ligament. And what it did is when it moves, it pinched all of his nerves through his body, and it was just screwing his whole body up.
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man.
I was numbing all my arms and my legs. I had muscle spasms all over my body, like my toes. My fingers would just twitch constantly by themselves. My eyeballs would twitch by themselves. I couldn't focus on things. I couldn't make a fist with these hands. My ears are ringing like somebody lights a firecracker off or something. Ringing in the ears like that, 24 hours around the clock. I'd stand up and I'd get, it's called vertigo. I'd get really dizzy and I didn't have any balance. I had 0 degree movement from my waist up to my head for about 8 months. I couldn't move at all. My head was fixated, but it wasn't fixated at like a straight angle. It was kind of to the side.
That is one of the worst things that could ever happen to somebody.
It was really pretty sad to watch Danny go through that because he was such an active person and that just so immobilized him.
I thought there'd be almost no other worse torment than that. To have had that much and to not be able to use it to have it shut off in your prime.
It was torture for him. And it was torture to stand by and watch it and know that you can't do anything. You know, there's nothing I can do. Sorry, Danny, hope you feel better, you know?
I remember talking to him and thinking and asking him, or getting around to it, if he felt suicidal. And I remember leaving this place not being convinced that he wasn't.
I went and stayed in Hawaii with a witch doctor for a couple months. Tried some pretty crazy stuff with that, getting hypnotized, doing all kinds of spiritual stuff, like mental healing stuff. I just had gotten back on the ramp like 2 days before they were gonna finish the video, and I got like two tricks on film. To me, I was blown away. Even had that, I was so stoked that I'd got some sort of footage for that video. Tampa was like maybe a few weeks later. I entered the vert contest. I got first and second in the street contest that day. When you're out for a year and a half and people are telling you you're pretty much a wreck, you're done with, and then you come back and do something like that, I felt pretty good at that time.
What it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man behind the line.
Yeah, for all the people that might have counted Danny out after his injuries, he showed them all that, you know, nothing's gonna hold him back. That was great.
Like working a full-time job and trying to skateboard professionally at the same time. There's too much stress.
They tried really hard to keep it together, and they made it really feel like a team. But in the end, it just came down to the business of it.
Anyway, is one tough human being. Take me in, I want out, that's all I
need. There's no runway on that rail, and you gotta come around a corner and cut into it. Dude, I thought I broke my femur on that one. That was one of the gnarliest slams I've ever had. That was one of the craziest rails I ever tried to do too. That thing was huge. I went there with Duffy, tried to get some inspiration. He even got hurt trying it too. We slammed within 10 minutes of each other because the thing was really wobbly. The thing just launched both of us right on our faces so quickly. I don't know, I'm kind of sketched on the rails now after having my knee blown out and stuff.
I was trying to grind an 18 stair handrail with a really, really narrow runway, and I couldn't get the angle to ollie onto it so I could get on top of the rail. I was going too parallel with it. So I ollied up onto it and I did like a wheel 50-50 on it. Just kind of slipped, almost like I was gonna land on my back on the rail, and I got one leg over the rail. So it almost looked like I was gonna crash my nuts on the rail and my knee popped out sideways. And I tore the ACL, the PCL, and the meniscus.
Dude is so gnarly. He had knee surgery. 4 or 5 months out of knee surgery, you're not supposed to even be on your skateboard for 6 months. He's jumping out of a helicopter, and he jumps out of a helicopter and leans back and tears his shoulder.
Fell back pretty hard on my side right here, and my arm was up like this pretty much, and my just the impact of the weight of my body slamming on my side pushed my elbow pretty much hit me in the head. I disattached a ligament in there called the labrum. Luckily, I didn't destroy the rotator cuff or the joint capsule on my shoulder, but they had to go in there and reattach the ligament and tack it back down to the bone.
I talked to him about it, and I said, Danny, how's your shoulder? And he's like, yeah, it's jacked. I got to go in for surgery next week. And I'm like, your knee just got back, and you're already jumping out. And he's like, oh, it was a freak accident. You know, your back comes to the freak accident. I'm like, you're jumping out of a helicopter. How could anything that happened to you be a freak accident when you're jumping out of a helicopter? And he's just like, no, you don't understand, man. You don't understand. I just leaned back a little bit too much. And I'm like, I understand, dude. You jumped out of a helicopter into like a 20-foot vert ramp. What's there to not understand? But what I'm telling you is that why? Why so soon, you know? Like, and he's just like, it had nothing to do with my knee. And I'm just like, all right, he just doesn't even get it. He's too gnarly for his own good.
Yeah, I did it. I mean, I knew my shoulder was gone. I was like, when they aired it on TV, like they asked me, like, hey, are you gonna try it again? I'm like, yeah, my shoulder's blown out. I think I tore some ligaments, but I gotta do it before it really the pain really kicks in. So I went right back up and tried it a couple more times, and then I pulled it.
And most people think, all right, if I fall on this again, my arm might fall off. But he thinks it was a freak accident the last time. There's no way it's gonna happen again. I'm making the next one. And he makes the next one. That's what makes him different than everybody else. I'm just going, man, this guy just won't quit. He can do anything he wants to. Anything he puts his mind to, if his body will hold up.
Sure enough, like an hour later, my shoulder just froze up, got crazy swollen, and I had the high air contest 2 days later too, and I did that.
That guy just can't get enough. He seriously can't get enough.
And I think it puts him in a hard position because he's going to be living on painkillers for the rest of his life.
Just amazes me that he could jump out of a helicopter twice, tear the ligaments in his shoulder, do it 3 more times, make it, you know, sit on aspirin for the next 2 days, and then win the high air contest, and then go into surgery a week later for his shoulder.
He has abilities and gifts that, like, I've never seen. I've seen very few other people be able to step on one thing and step to another and be able to do it almost at the same level.
It's a maniac on a motorcycle also.
Danny's a really good father.
Whatever he wants to do, he does and wins.
I still look at him as having probably some of the most gifts that any one single human, you know, or one skater has ever had.
To me, Danny Way, that name in my head is synonymous with progression.
I don't think Danny's just like one of the best skateboarders in the world. I honestly believe, like, as far as like raw talent goes, Danny's one of the best athletes in the world. Don't tell him I said this. I'd honestly put him up there with, like, seriously, people like Jordan and other people on that level.
In my opinion, there's no skater out there who's as gnarly as Danny Way, like, or has been. He's been the best skateboarder that I ever lived.
He's always pretty much, you know, blown my mind. I mean, since day one, I mean, D1, since day one.
You know, snarly, Danny landed a 900 like 10 years ago and then fell off on the flat bottom.
that's the thing, that those are the people that we elevate to superstar status just for the sheer fact that they are that good. And Danny Way is one of those people. I'm gonna go get some more.